Oh, give thanks to the Lord. The Lord hears the cries of the people.
Give thanks to the Lord.
The works of the Lord are great. Remember what God has done.
Give thanks to the Lord.
God has done miracles, and the Lord always remembers God's covenant.
Give thanks to the Lord.
Glory and praise is due to the Lord.
Servant of the poor, choosing to give as you desire, You show us the last so that we can make them first in our hearts and hopes. Doing no wrong, you make us right with God for all time. Fresh as the water which turns a desert into a meadowland of flowers, Spirit of uninterrupted grace, you come to us. When we would grumble, you give us the gospel to live out. When we would protest, you teach us songs of praise. When we would utter laments, you fill us with God's laughter. God and community, holy and one, refresh us with your presence today. Amen. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. With that assurance and the promise of God's grace through Jesus the Christ, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let us pray. Gracious God, we have sought after things, but we have not sought after you. We have expected generosity, but we have not shown generosity. We have not been gracious or grateful. We have failed to remember all that you have done. Forgive us and fill our hearts with gratitude. Help us to share our gifts and strengthen our legs so that we can run after you, God. In Jesus' name we pray.
Chapter 3, verse 10 through chapter 4 of 11. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, he's talking about Nineveh, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, Is it right for you to be angry? Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head, to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, It is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, Is it right for you to be angry about the bush? And he said, Yes, angry enough to die. Then the Lord said, You are concerned about the bush for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 people who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals? This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Can't think of a time when the Old Testament lesson and the New Testament lesson go together so well as in today's lectionary readings. The New Testament lesson comes from the Gospel of Matthew, begins with chapter 20, verse 1. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for their usual daily wage, he sent them into this vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right. So they went. And he went out again at noon and about 3 o'clock, and he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, Why are you standing here idle all day? And they said to him, Because no one has hired us. He said to them, You also go into the vineyard. When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to the manager, Call the laborers and give them their pay. Beginning with the last and then going to the first. When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought that they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, These last workers worked for only an hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day, the scorching heat. And he replied to one of them, Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
When you're a parent or grandparent, I imagine that the three words you look forward to hearing the most from your youngins are, I love you. And pictures that they've drawn with those words unbearable. Even better. Hearing that little voice say those three words just warms your heart. And children learn very quickly how powerful these words are to adults, don't they? Unfortunately, they are not the only three words that we hear as parents and grandparents. The other three words are, that's not fair. It's not fair that I have to do my work before I play with my Kindle. That's not a judgment. Kids are just self-centered. Because to a child, they are the center of the universe. And we teach our children at a very early age that life is supposed to be fair. If you learn the rules and what happens when you follow the rules, and when you don't follow the rules, then you know what to expect from life. Fairness gives life structure. But kids push the definitions of fairness. It is so obvious to us, but to them, all they can see is how unfair this seems because they didn't get their way. Hopefully, our youngins will come to understand that the universe doesn't revolve around them. They will develop a sense of empathy and compassion for others. Unfortunately, some adults never grow out of that mindset. Learning about fairness is a good thing because that sense of fairness, when developed into maturity, is the foundation for justice and equality. It is not fair that some can vote and others cannot, that some have to ride in front of the bus while others must stay in the back, that some are paid more for the same work, that some go to bed hungry while others fill landfills with their excess. Yes, our innate sense of fairness can lead to a strong and life-giving sense of justice. We recognize that life is not always fair. It's not fair that a young person loses their life before they're 25, while another person lives a reckless and tough life and lives to be late in their 90s. That's not fair. If I were to ask you to fill in the blank, life is not fair because all of you would be able to fill in the blank with something that you know is fundamentally not fair. But here's the thing. Most of the time when we think about life being fair, it is about life not being fair to us. The parable Jesus gives us in our lesson today is a good example of that. Jesus begins his story with these words, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who goes out early in the morning to find workers for the field." There was a time when I was making regular trips to the Presbytery office in Hoover, and there was on a corner there on Warner Road where Hispanics stood, people who didn't have a regular paying job. So they congregated in this one place where contractors knew well, and then they had to wait for someone to drive up and hire them for the day. Several times I would witness this. A truck would pull up and a man would get out and say, "I need 5 workers today." And the first 5 workers to make it into the truck got the job. The others had to wait for the next person needing workers. Sometimes I would drive there around 4 o'clock and there would still be workers there, hoping and willing to go and do whatever kind of work needed to be done. There were always more workers than there were jobs. And I think maybe that explains why the landowner in Jesus' story keeps going back and hiring more workers. Maybe at first he thought 10 men would be enough, but by mid-morning he realized the job was just not going to get done with just 10 men. So he goes and picks out more men, men willing to work at whatever kind of job was available. By the afternoon, the landowner sees that he's still going to need even more. So back to town to hire a few more people to get this job done. The men who were hired first keep seeing new people arrive on the job site. And when the day is done and the people line up to get paid, the workers who had been working all day see how much those hired last get paid. And they get excited because they are, in their minds, calculating how much more they're going to get paid. I mean, that's fair, isn't it? Yeah. A denarian in Jesus' day would have been enough to feed and take care of someone for a couple of days. Look how much those people got who only worked for 2 hours. Except when they walk up to receive their wages, they receive the same amount that the workers did who were just hired 2 hours earlier. What? But we've worked 12 hours. We've been here all day. Why aren't we receiving more than those who only worked 2 hours? It isn't fair. And they were right, it wasn't fair. And the landowner responds, "But this is what you agreed to be paid. Take your money and go home. It's my money. I can do with it as I please." And at the end, Jesus says, "And the last shall be first, and the first shall be last." It isn't fair, is it? But this parable is not about being fair. And for years and years, I thought it was. I thought it was about saying that God's fairness is like, you know, way up there, and our fairness, or our sense of fairness, is down here. We just can't understand God's sense of fairness. And because it's God, we just have to live with it and trust that God understands why God's not being fair. But this parable is not about being fair. It's a story about God meeting each and every one of our needs. Those people who were looking for work, they were ready to work. They needed to work. They were willing to work. It's not their fault that they did not get hired until the end of the day. They needed to feed their family the next day, just like those who were lucky enough to be chosen first. Today, there are single parents who cannot work a job that requires them to be there early in the morning. They have kids to get dressed, to feed, and so they can only work a job that allows them to work while their kids are in school. And if they homeschool their children, well, that's another situation. In Jesus' parable, the landowner paid attention to those on the edges of society, those with the smallest amount of power and privilege, and realized that they too deserved a daily wage. Their deepest needs and God's justice can be met by a sustainable wage. Now, notice that it all starts out with seeing those ignored. Those ignored first, or maybe the second time, or until we see them, maybe the 34th time. And as we pay attention, justice can become a reality. Once seen and known, those needs can be met by the power and the privilege entrusted to the community's care. Seeing is followed by action, and that matters in this case, a living wage. The landowner had the courage and the guts to do it once he saw those seemingly invisible persons. Dr. Lee Henson Hastie says in a sermon on this passage, Never underestimate the gift and the power of seeing what others cannot see. Moreover, who others cannot see. Maybe you have heard that what appears to be in a forest of aspen trees is only one tree connected to the same buried root system. Water that appears to be one tree, if you water one tree, you water the whole forest. Harm one tree and the whole forest suffers. He goes on to say that we are all in this together. We all have needs that need to be met. When we first went into the pandemic showed us just how essential workers are. Of course, the first responders were essential workers. And then we realized that nurses, the doctors, were the heroes. In fact, every person who worked in the health field was an essential worker. But how about the stock person that put food out there on the shelves for us? The cashiers who bring up our purchases? The UPS men and women who delivered packages for us when we couldn't get out of the house? The postmen and postwomen who delivered our mail? Aren't they all essential workers? In our parable today, the landowner listens to the disgruntled worker's complaints, and then he calls them friend and reminds them that, in fact, what he has decided is totally fair. They are being paid just what was promised. If anything, the landowner is being more than fair, actually downright generous to those who were invited late in the day, as well as perfectly fair to those who were fortunate to be called to work early. Why then begrudge such generosity? Those who had been working in the field all day had the option to respond in one of two ways. They could see how much the ones who worked only an hour got paid and be envious. Think for a moment of what envy did to those grumbling day workers. Rather than feeling glad to have found work all day, they felt resentful at not having received more. Rather than rejoicing that these other workers who waited all day for the prospect of work could return home blessed to be able to feed their families, they could only begrudge them, perhaps even curse them for their good fortune. And rather than be grateful to the landowner who has given them an honest day's wage for an honest day's work, they can only grumble with resentment. The parable reminds me of what is usually known as the parable of the prodigal son. It wasn't fair that the son who demanded his inheritance before his father died, which was a slap in the face, it wasn't fair that he was treated so royally. And the other son, who had always been so obedient to his father, didn't feel so celebrated. He just couldn't put himself in his brother's shoes and realize how wonderful forgiveness and grace could be. It simply wasn't fair. But like our parable for the day, that parable wasn't about fairness either. The lessons of Scripture remind us that we often focus on the wrong things, what our neighbors have, instead of what those in power have. Did you know that just a handful of people have more wealth than the rest of the world's population? Paul Frantz says that people don't have a strong, intuitive sense of how much bigger 1 billion is than 1 million. A million seconds is 11 days. A billion seconds is 31 and a half years. That's a big difference. A million seconds is 11 days. A billion seconds is 31 and a half years. Charlotte Dudley Cleghorn writes, "It's not about receiving a fair wage. It's about the generosity of God, about a gracious and undeserved gift. What if, instead of seeing the world as either fair or not fair, we looked at the world with the assumptions that God loves me and all of creation deeply and profoundly. I and all others are made God's generosity is beyond our wildest imaginations. There's nothing that I can do to deserve God's generosity. Poor Jonah, upset with God, because God cares for all of God's creation. Upset with God for God's generosity to others. You and I are invited and challenged to look at where we see ourselves in Jesus' parable. It invites us to transform pride, envy, or hardness into joy by admiring and celebrating God's astonishing generosity. Jesus leaves us with a question. Can we learn to see others through God's eyes? When we look for fairness, can we see generosity? Dr. Henson Hasty writes, "Who knows, by God's grace and through our very eyes and actions, we could be the answer to why a person or group will surely experience belonging to God. Wouldn't that be awesome?" Just let that be our aim. Let us pray. God of justice and mercy, we confess that it's easier for us to argue with one another than address systemic injustice. It's easier for us to be jealous and angry about unfairness we experience than to be concerned that our neighbors have their needs met. Forgive us our short-sightedness. Call us into the work of justice with compassion, to love our neighbors and to seek justice for those around us. We remember that when we care for the needs of others, our own needs will be met. When we speak against injustice for others, we work for justice for ourselves. Remind us that we are interconnected with one another, that none of us are truly alone. Call us into your beloved community to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with you. Amen.
Suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried.
God of glory. We come before you in prayer today, assured and comforted by the promise that when we do not know how to pray as we ought, your Holy Spirit intercedes for us with sighs too deep for words. Lord, the burdens and challenges of life leave us speechless. We thank you that even as we pray, Jesus prays for us to be one and strengthened for the ministry to which you call us. We pray for the people who have been named in worship today. Those names are on our prayer list, whom we carry in our hearts, who are known only to you. We pray for your church in every place, so that we may bear faithful witness to your amazing grace in our lives and in the world, even when it offends our sense of fairness and our understanding of the way life ought to be. We pray for the mission, ministry, and the work of this congregation. May we always serve with the spirit of generosity as we depend upon your gifts, rather than a sense of scarcity that comes from looking to ourselves. We pray for the peoples of this world whom you have created in your own image, for those who are in dangerous places through no fault of their own, for those who have experienced disasters that have upended their lives, for those who are oppressed and long to live as free people, for those who mourn and long to have hope in their lives. Almighty God, help us to live lives worthy of the calling to which you call us. Remind us that we are the body of Christ. When one member suffers, we all share the suffering and extend the loving care of Christ. When one member is honored, may we all rejoice together rather than be envious of another's blessings. Lord God, help us to live, to love, and to serve as faithful followers of Jesus the Christ in your kingdom. And now we pray the prayer Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The Apostle Paul wrote to the Corinthians, For the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. Let us bring our offerings to God, even as we present ourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. Gracious God, we know that every generous act of giving with every perfect gift is from above, coming down from you. We thank you for your many blessings, especially your perfect gift of your Son, Jesus the Christ. Help us to receive your gifts and grace with thanksgiving and humility, and to use them faithfully in and for your kingdom. We ask this in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.